I'm Salima Ikram, and I'm here to welcome you to the first Archaeological Institute of Houston's Facebook teeny-weeny lectures. I'm an Egyptologist, and I am also, like everyone else, facing the whole issue of corona. It's really strange and difficult for all of us because we're so isolated, and we're used to being with people. We're used to having some sort of contact, and it's really hard for all of us, I think, to live in this very peculiar way with no idea as to when it might end. But one good thing that's come out of it is that people are reconnecting with their inner chef. And this is quite fun because I work on ancient Egyptian food, and I have been playing with some recipes to try and come up with what the ancient Egyptians might have eaten. Of course, I live in an apartment, so it's very difficult to cook over an open fire, but certainly if you have that option, you can do a lot of ancient Egyptian cooking. The ancient Egyptians were extremely social people, much as the modern Egyptians are, and they used to spend a lot of time, and partially due to their religious cycles, but as well as social and cultural habits, getting together, having parties, cooking, eating, because of course food is what really brings us all together. Breaking bread with someone is an act of great friendship and trust, and that was the case for the ancient Egyptians as well. So the ancient Egyptians had a lot of fun feasting and eating and drinking, and people tend to say, oh, the ancient Egyptians are obsessed by death, because of course all we really know are the tombs. But in fact, the tombs are really a way for the ancient Egyptians to continue life, to celebrate life. And what they did was, anything that was in the tomb, drawn or physically put there, the idea was that magically it would become real and you could have access to it for eternity. So of course they put all of their favorite things into the tomb, and that included food. You see all aspects of food production going on. It's always, you know, the best time of year when you're planting, sowing, or when you're harvesting, and then they show the results. And they also put lots of food inside their tombs. But one of the chief things that they liked to do was have parties, feasts and banquets. And the ancient Egyptians depict these with great detail on their walls of their tombs, and it is nice to see, you know, these tables groaning with lots of fresh fruit and vegetables. They had different kinds of lettuce, sort of like romaine was their favorite and most commonly found even in Egypt today. It was supposed to be an aphrodisiac, and they also would have grapes, dates, lots of different kinds of dates, dom pom fruit, and also pomegranates, and lots of figs. And of course, I'm starting out with dessert first, because that's obviously how I think of my meals. The rest of it, so moving backwards, the main course would probably have been, depends how wealthy you were, but in an ideal tomb, you would have had roast goose, roast duck. You could have had lots of different kinds of meat. The ancient Egyptians, in fact, invented barbecue. Barbecued ribs are a specialty, and they would put these, and after they'd cooked them, they'd mummify them, they'd wrap them up, put them in boxes, often in the shape of whatever it was that was being put in, and put these into the tomb. So Tutankhamun had over 40 boxes of food. You have to remember, though, he was a growing boy, he was a teenager, so they wanted to make sure that he was not going to be hungry in the afterlife. So barbecued ribs, large chunks of meat, lots of steak, all of this was provided. We have to remember that for the ancient Egyptians, there were no chickens, there were no potatoes, there were no tomatoes, and they didn't really have pasta, wheat, or rice. So bread was their main starch, and they ate that with everything. And of course, they had lots and lots of beer that they made with bread, and wine. Now, interestingly, Tutankhamun's tomb is not well equipped with beer jars, but that boy has a lot of wine, both red and white. So he was making sure he had enough to last him for all of eternity. Lentils, garbanzo beans, chickpeas, things like that, onions, garlic, cumin to add flavoring. So basically the Egyptians sort of showed you all of this stuff, and they had fish and pork, beef, sometimes forms of venison, as it were, not from red deer, but from gazelles and other and oryxes. But anyway, so the ancient Egyptians had a huge variety of food, and they would depict this on their tomb walls. And they also had fish. I don't mention that as often because I'm not as fond of it, I suppose. But anyway, you can see these massive feasts that the Egyptians had. So basically, if you want to start cooking like an ancient Egyptian, you have the basic recipes there, or the basic materials, and maybe we can start posting some recipes and ways of doing that in a modern kitchen so that you too can try these and eat like a pharaoh. Anyway, I hope everyone manages to make it through and check in with the archaeology lectures, because there are always interesting things about food and drink in the past, how people survived, how people entertained themselves. Imagine doing this without television and Netflix. So there's a lot that we have to be thankful for.